科技的发展、产品的变革、商业模式的创新，造就了许多创业神话，他们的影响深入到千家万户的日常生活。但这些创业神话不仅是源于创业者自身的想法和努力，还归功于他特殊的运作方式——风险投资。创业者身后那些听起来神秘遥远的投资人，逐渐从幕后走到台前，引起了大众的好奇与追逐。在投资了脸书、特斯拉、 ICQ 这些全球顶尖风险投资人的眼中，将引领人类文明进步和社会变革的下一波科技浪潮是什么？伯乐如何选出千里马？在一周之内做出的投资决定如何赚到近3000倍？长久不衰的创业秘密又是什么？
创业时代的本质呢，就是青年人敢于去实现他们的梦想。
而且现在感觉就在中国啊，起码就创业感觉已经变成一种时尚潮流了。
因为不创业已经是冒险了。这个唱一首20年前风靡中国大地的歌，对吧，叫做我把青春赌明天，你用真情换此生，就是我拿股份赌明天，你用风险换此生。
从1998年被誉为中国风险投资之父陈思威的政协一号提案开始，引发了一场高科技产业浪潮。而在政府2015年推出大众创业万众创新的政策后，更是在全国掀起了一股创业新高潮。美国科技投资第一人也是脸书的投资人布雷爷认为，未来5年至10年内，全世界最有价值的公司排行榜上至少有7-8家会来自中国和美国。在风险投资对创业创新强大的助推力之下，一系列中国公司将成长为世人瞩目的行业巨无霸，大有与曾经的偶像分庭抗礼之势。
Having visited with leaders in October, Jack Ma, Pony Ma, Robin Li, they are exceptional. And the Chinese leadership, the intensity, the focus around continuing to educate and scale their organizations compares very favorably with the rest of the world. And I would bet a lot of money, and am betting a lot of money, that Chinese internet entrepreneurs and the Chinese internet leaders will continue to exceed plans. And I'm also quite optimistic about the Chinese economy, not just in the next couple of years, but this year. And I feel there's a real chance that the Chinese internet economy, as well as the overall economy, will exceed many of the forecasts that we've seen over the last couple of years.
德瑞普出生于风险投资世家，他的爷爷创办了硅谷的第一家风险投资基金，家族与中国渊源颇深。他的爷爷见过毛泽东，父亲见过邓小平，而他自己则作为硅谷第一个进入中国的风险投资家而延续了家族传统。他的投资包括特斯拉、Skype、Hotmail、百度和分众传媒等。
The government, on the other hand, is trying to start this entrepreneurship movement in China, where, you know, innovation and entrepreneurship are becoming such buzzwords. What do you think about this mass entrepreneurship movement?
I think it's fantastic. I think it's already there. All throughout China, there are so many great entrepreneurs. I've seen so many great companies come out of there.Great technologies. Some are even more advanced than what I've seen here in the Silicon Valley. And it's like a great renaissance. It's one of the great things that's happened in our world is the rise of China and all the great things that are happening.
And we see that in China, they started with copying successful models from the West. But now with, you know, Tencent, Baidu, Alibaba, DJI,Do you think that they have a chance to lead the innovation wave, or is it just commercialization of the leading technologies from the West?
No, I think the same thing happened when in England they used to say, those people from the colonies, meaning the U.S., they're good at manufacturing, but they'll never invent anything new, and they're just copying or whatever.And then all of a sudden America became this innovation center of the world. I think the same thing could happen to China as long as the borders and the money flow all stays open.
以色列的科技创业教父瓦尔迪认为， 中国的公司在过去20年一直致力于满足国内市场，而当国内市场被满足，中国企业即将进军世界时，巨大的国内市场将为中国企业提供非同寻常的坚实基础。74岁的瓦尔迪相信，一旦中国企业走出去，将迎来一波大爆发。
Now you look what two companies, Huawei and Alibaba, were able to achieve in the world. Okay, on the world market. And you ask yourself, what happened when all these companies, which basically are still domestic or majority domestic companies, when they begin to feel that they finish to utilize the local market and they begin to look on the international market the same way that Huawei and Alibaba are looking on the international market, you will see a huge explosion of technology and services and products from China to the rest of the world. And this expansion will create more jobs in China,which will inspire more young Chinese to go into the startup industry. So what I think what we see in China right now is before the volcano. You know, it's just getting more and more and more stream because the thing which China sell to the world are in many cases are assembling thing, etc. But when you talk about original product like Alibaba and Huawei, you multiply, you add to it all the rest of the industry plus new companies which will be created, it's mind-boggling.
美国硅谷是创新的代名词，是全球许多地方追寻的神话。从中国硅谷到世界中关村，中美创业者之间的差距不断缩小，有的领域甚至实现弯道超车。徐小平曾与俞敏洪、王强并称为新东方三驾马车，后成为中国最早也是最著名的一批天使投资人，为这个趋势感到振奋。
就从创新这个行业来说，中国在过去3-5年开始出现了大量的原创的东西，导致了美国人知道抄我们，所以过去叫 copy to China， 现在是 copy from China， 这个趋势会继续深化下去。在整个中国创业领域里边，这样的故事啊，可以说比比皆是，越来越多，这是令人非常激动的。
许多创业者在风险投资人那里画下的大饼，后来果然变成了现实。每一位风险投资人都津津乐道于分析下一个风口，预测下一个即将被彻底颠覆的行业，关心创业者告诉他们的每一个异想天开的主意。毕竟科技的进步往往伴随着听起来疯狂的奇思妙想。
So what do you think will drive our civilization in the next say 10 to 20 years?
A major trend is going to be a health, because the abilityto be connected 24/7, to have a computer, a very powerful computer in your pocket with lot of sensors. Lot of sensors are now coming into being. Plus, wisdom of the crowd, that you collect data from many, many people. Plus, the ability to deal with big data, with large quantities of data, is going to open a whole new approach to health.
There are a number of different large industries that I think are being reshaped in some positive ways. So I start with medicine because I'm seeing computing and artificial intelligence make a huge difference. There are efforts where now through big data and cloud sharing, they are sharing data about different outcomes on prescriptions for cancer patients. If 1995 was a wonderful time to be investing in the internet, if 2005 was a wonderful time for me to be investing in Facebook and social networks, this is a wonderful time for entrepreneurs and venture capitalists to be starting artificial intelligence technology companies. around the world, and I think this is a golden age.
And what are some crazy ideas that you're seeing now that might be able to turn into great ideas?
We're seeing some really interesting breakthroughs in medicine, where people are able to print genes so that you can insert some sort of a gene that's more powerful than the genes in your body, and then they would replicate themselves. I think more and more things are going to happen out there in space. I know people are looking at space mining and settling on the moon, settling on Mars. I know Elon's going to get us to Mars by 2019, so I'm pretty excited
about
that.
You're betting on it.
Absolutely, counting on making a trip.
So how does the future look to you in 10 years?
Very bright. The future to me looks like people become much more fluid. Geographic borders will probably be gone. Most governments will be virtual. We will probably be in autonomous cars, but they may actually be flying autonomous cars.
You've been looking for that for years.
Yeah. I've got a couple of investments, and I'm hoping that they can make that happen. I think there will be probably cancer cures, or at least people will be able to live with pretty much any cancer. So we're going to live a lot longer. I think finance is going to be completely different. I think we're going to be using generally digital currency everywhere because it's going to win the battle against fiat currency.
下一节，我们继续倾听这些顶级投资人如何做出投资决定，和在他们眼中，创业者怎样的素质和特质会吸引他们。
现实非常残酷，总是拿得出计划书的创业者多，肯拿出真金白银的投资者少。对于创业者来说，说服投资人只是漫漫征途的第一步，是什么特质能让他们跑赢？而对于投资者来说，怎样才能在无数的创业项目中筛选出成功率最高的项目？这也是一门艺术。而对于几位顶级的投资人来说，他们格外看重的不是 idea，而是人。
What about Mark that really, you know, made you to yes so fast?
Mark had great courage. He had great product passion. And sometimes everything is in the details. I had looked at a number of social networking companies, but they weren't deep when it came to technology or product or platform, companies such as Friendster and others. And Mark, even at age 20, was passionate about the product. On the cover of the homepage, at the bottom, it said a Mark Zuckerberg production. And that's when I knew he really owned the product and cared. And the other attribute where I think Mark is still underrated is the talent that he hires and assembles at Facebook for over 10 years, continue to profoundly influence Facebook. In China, we do incredible detailed reference checks on an entrepreneur's hometown friends, on the hometown school teachers, and we go back into the childhood to do very deep, very significant reference checks. In the United States, in Silicon Valley, we don't go as far back. Maybe we should. But what we do is spend a lot of time on the technology due diligence, as well as some of the recent reference checks. In general, most of the questions are around, does the founder and the founder team have an owner mentality? Does he or she deeply care about building a scalable, important product and business? Will he or she hire excellent people and build out a team? And then, of course, really understanding how good are the technologists.
布雷也认为，中国的创业者比美国的创业者更加渴望财富，这种文化跟硅谷不大一样。对此，他向中国的创业者提出了忠告和建议。
In Silicon Valley, people are thinking 24 hours a day, 7 days a week about the technology, the innovation, hiring the very best data scientists, the very best machine learning individuals, students, teachers who understand algorithms. It's 24/7. And my advice to many of the Chinese entrepreneurs, hire great talent and spend a lot of time attracting and retaining that great talent. And it's not just around finance, it's not just around marketing and sales, it's true product talent and engineering talent. And that's what I believe the Chinese internet companies and technology companies can continue to do just a little bit better.
50年前创办了以色列最早软件公司的瓦尔迪，从创业者成为世界互联网最早的投资者之一。大半生辉煌的从业生涯令他积累了一套投人哲学和考察创业者的方法。
What did I know about internet when they came to me? I didn't have any idea. Actually, I thought that it was a ridiculous idea that why anybody, instead of making a phone call, will begin to type. Sounds to me ridiculous. Eventually, I came slowly to the conclusion that maybe I was wrong at that time. I used to think that ideas are overrated, and today I know that ideas are not overrated. Ideas are almost non-relevant. What is relevant is the execution.
But how do you judge when someone comes to find you? How do you tell that someone will be good at execution?
You go to a school. You enter a class, let's say class of 16 years old students. You want to know who is the smarter student in the class. What will you do?
Their friends?
Very good. I told you yesterday you are a smart lady. The friends. You know, the teacher don't know, the parents don't know, the principal don't know, but the friends know exactly that when they need help, to whom they will go. And not necessarily they will go to the guy with or the lady with the highest grade. They will, it can be a shy person who is not, and yet the friends know that he knows. So the best way to know who is talented is to ask the other people.
投资人评估创业者的标准有共通之处，但有趣的是，他们眼里优秀的创业者却并不相像，就宛如这些创业者亲手打造的产品和缔造的公司，性格鲜明，各有特色。
And what are some common things that you see in good entrepreneurs?
Well, what's interesting about entrepreneurs is that the best entrepreneurs don't really have anyone like them.
All unique.
They're very unique.Yeah, and Robin Lee has a very nice, steady tone. People naturally want to work with him. They all want to make him happy. They want him to succeed. They'll do anything they can, I would, to make him more successful. Many of the other great leaders.
Jack Ma
is this so passionate. He's just...taking people, he's dragging people with him to make this, that company so successful. So they all have different personalities, different ways of looking at things. But, and some of them are just seeing something out there in the future that's just a little different, and it has a chance of success.
For young, aspiring entrepreneurs, they don't need to fit in or they don't need to try to be someone else.
No.
创业是否有路径可循？正是因为有人说创业不能被教授，德瑞普决定接受这个挑战，在硅谷创办英雄学院来培养年轻的创业者。英雄学院已经有来自60个国家的800名毕业生，开了约300家公司，筹集了数亿美金，走上了一条也许充满挫折但志在改变世界的创业之路。
And I think it's because a lot of education is keeping people in blocks. They just stay in their place and they listen and they learn and then they repeat what they've heard. And that's the way education has been for all these years. Well, we're teaching them to think for themselves and do things and go out there and try things and fail and lose face, whatever it is. And then they go out and they do it again.
And how do you teach them to fail?
We get them comfortable with failing. We get them up in front of the class doing something that we know they will fail at.
Intentionally.
We put them through survival training. Part of the survival training is, okay, you've got 24 hours, go get a job offer on paper and come back. It's got to be from somebody you don't know. And they all, most of them, come back with job offers. So then they go, oh, well, worst case, I can always get a job.
So I might as well go out and try something.
It's all experiential.
And you think that's important?
I do, because if you're an entrepreneur, you're up against a lot. And if you're a successful entrepreneur, you're up against many more things. Your competitors start coming after you, lawsuits, governments, lots of things come after you. So you have to be able to stand strong and tall, even if you're under attack by all of these other forces, so that your business can see its way through and see to the other side of the tunnel.
经得起失败，受得起挫折，是年轻创业者的必修课。但年轻人创业之前，也要先理智地问问自己，我这个技能是不是别人没有的，是不是社会需要的，如何才能培养这些技能？
这样说吧，所有的绝望的人其实是自己能力不足。 OK， 能力也包括资源，对吧？我对他们的建议就是先找一份工作，积累一些经验。曾经我也是个失败者。而这个优秀的定义，每一个失败者其实都是一个优秀的人，因为在创业的时代，优秀的定义就是我有一点点他人所需要的技能。天使投资的本质是什么？对于你认定的优秀的青年人的一种梦想的赞助。
也许风险投资和创业最大的魅力，也是最大的挑战，就在于它没有万无一失的公式。其实天时地利人和缺一不可。但我想万变不离其中的投资成功秘诀就是看人。其实创业的失败率啊是高达90%，那些成功的创业者其实面临的概率是一样的。那为什么他们能成功呢？我想很大的一个原因就是因为他们热爱他们所做的事业，能够号召一帮人跟着他们一起去往前走，在失败以后再站起来，付出200%的努力，在坚持再坚持的这些跌跌碰碰中，继续去反省学习，摸索出一条成功之路。我想这个就是创业的成功秘诀。
下一集，全球最大搞笑内容网站 NiGag 创始人陈展成将为我们讲述年轻的香港创业团队如何打造出传播欢乐的世界级平台，和在他观察下全球年轻人的喜好趋势。
接着为您播出雅居乐地产筑梦天下。